Hi, Tosh.
Hi.
Okay, so everybody has some, every bride, I feel like, has some sort of category in their wedding that they're just like kind of obsessed with, you know, be it flowers, be it dress, hair, makeup, whatever. Personally, I'm really into hair and makeup, so I'm so excited for this podcast.
I wish we would have had hair and makeup for today.
I know. That's true. Absolutely. So I have so many questions. But I guess what was your, just in a nutshell, what was your makeup experience?
My makeup experience is a close friend of mine who was part of the wedding party is a makeup artist.
Okay.
For film and TV. Mm-hmm. And she offered as her gift to me to do mm-hmm. not only my makeup, but the rest of our wedding party. So she did both of our moms and everybody else in the wedding party. And prior to the day, we went makeup shopping. She told me exactly what to buy. We tried colors and everything. So she told me which makeup to buy, which brushes to get. And because she wanted me to be able to carry it on after the wedding, so mm-hmm. get my own brushes. And right. then that was that. For hair, another friend of mine, also in the wedding, decided to, as her gift to us, pay for everybody's hair to be done.
Awesome.
At a salon. So that was mm-hmm. really awesome. But we'll get into that in just a minute, like trials and stuff mm-hmm. like that. How about yeah. you, Jeannie?
I researched, you know, I went online and then ultimately I ended up going with a referral. And I loved her work. I loved what she did. And I had a trial with her and that was really, in a nutshell, my experience. I was really happy with it in the end. Everything that she did.
What made you decide on her? Was it just the fact that she had worked with somebody and they were happy? You liked the way their makeup turned out in their pictures?
I loved my trial at the end of the day. That's really what it came down to for me. You know, she came to my house. She did my makeup. And I was thrilled with how it came out. And after that, I was super comfortable. And that was really it. It was very simple for me. I said, if you can do my makeup today and it looks great and I want to go out and I'm happy with my face, then there's no reason I wouldn't be happy the day of. So hair, I went for a zillion trials. I spent way too much money. That was more of my own obsession.
So different team.
Yes, different team. Mm-hmm. My salon. Okay. And actually, it was awkward because I made everybody uncomfortable because I switched stylists to like three times. So that was real. I was very like pissnickety, I guess you could say. Mm-hmm. But yeah, so that was kind of a little bit of an intro to my insane experience with hair.
You were meticulous about selecting
the right team. Artist, yeah. mm-hmm.
Welcome to our podcast. So you're engaged.
Now what?
First, we just want to thank you so much for tuning in and listening to us. And also wanted to ask you, if you haven't already subscribed to So You're Engaged, Now What, please do so we can keep in touch. And if you would be so kind, give us a rating on Apple iTunes and whatever platform you're listening to us on. That would be great.
Today, we'll be talking to hair and makeup specialist Kathleen Benjamin. Hi, Kathleen.
Hi, how are you?
She's from Kathleen Benjamin On-Site Hair and Makeup. So welcome, welcome. Thank you so much. We have so many questions.
Yes, welcome.
Thank you,
Kathleen,
for having me here.
Of course. I would like to know, Natasha and I would like to know, a little bit about, you know, what got you into this whole hair and makeup situation? What's your background? You know, when did you start doing this?
Okay, so, God, I've been in the industry for close to 40 years now, so for quite a while.
Yeah.
I worked in a salon, you know, doing, you know, your regular haircuts and colors and whatnot. And when it came to doing updos, I had sort of like, I gravitated towards doing them. I really enjoyed doing them. And it's one of those things where either you love to do it or you hate to do it. And I just really always was very passionate about doing it and always wanted to learn more. And I felt like I was let my creative abilities really show through doing the updo stylings and the, you know, any of the event stylings that they had. So,
yeah, I've heard that. You know, I've spoken to so many hairstylists over the years, and a lot of the hairstylists that I've had conversations with that actually enjoy doing updos, they also tend to either they're, you know, a legitimate makeup artist or they've dabbed in makeup before, because I guess updos are more of a creative. Maybe I'm saying this out of, you know, I guess conversations I've had with people, but generally people that do color and cut only don't always venture into updos for some reason.
No, you're definitely right. I mean, it's like a specialty. It's like some people gravitate towards haircuts. Some people gravitate, like you said, towards color. I just always gravitated right towards like doing the updos and the salon.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So therefore, everybody just kind of booked me with the updos. And I just got noted for being that person to do them.
So. Okay. Okay.
So yeah. Kathleen, question. From somebody who did not go through the process of really selecting somebody to do my hair, it was gifted to me. Okay. Do you find that brides will come to you with a look that they are asking you to recreate? Or do you have your go-tos that if you're looking at the shape of somebody's face, length of hair, type of dress, what the neckline is, do you make your suggestions to them and say, this is what you have to do?
Yeah, you know what? That's always a tough spot to be in because I do have that happen to me all the time. They usually typically come in with like a picture from Pinterest or Instagram stating this is the style that they want. And unless you're that person in the picture, it's really hard to recreate that look on somebody else. So usually what I do right away is I will, even if I think it's against what's going to look good on them, I will do it anyway. Let them make the decision about it doesn't look good on me. And then we take it to the next step, which is typically, all right, let's see what does work good on you. And we'll just recreate something else. And, you know, you can usually tell by the look on their face if they're happy with the style or not. So.
Sure. Do you have them try on their gown once you have, if you do a trial for their hair or their makeup?
So yeah, I have them come in. Typically they bring somebody with them. I typically tell them to go home if they have their dress at home to go home and try it on, make sure that they're happy with it, you know, go out that night, whatever it may be. But I usually can gauge how they feel about the trial when I'm done with them, you know, whether or not they're happy or if they need to reschedule and come back, you know, to have a second trial, whether it's the hair that didn't work out or maybe they love the makeup, but if something wasn't quite right with the hair or they need hair extensions.
Kathleen, to clarify, so these brides actually come to your home?
They come to my studio, yes.
Okay, yeah. That's awesome. Yeah. I love that. So they come and with their now when they come for their trial, do you ask them to bring their gown initially, or do they sort of because they may not have it yet, right? So do they usually come for a second trial? How does that work?
Typically, they have the dress already. Okay. They usually have the venue, the dress, the photographer. So I'm like somewhere towards the middle, towards the end.
Okay.
And so they usually have scheduled the appointment like maybe a year, year and a half out. And then, you know, after they have their dress, they're ready to come in and schedule the trial. I don't have them bring their dress with them. No, I typically don't because I typically don't have it then. But I do have them go home and live with it and make sure they're happy with the style. Mm-hmm.
Do you always double book them hair and makeup?
I do. I do. I'll arrange to have another artist here at the same time. One of us does hair and the other one will do the makeup. And that way they can see what it will look like all together.
Oh, that's great. So are you also a makeup artist?
Yeah, I do both now.
You do both. Okay.
Yes, I do. Yeah.
Wonderful. So when they come to your house for a trial, what's the recommendation? Clean hair, dirty hair? What do you say?
One day blown out hair with some type of product in it. Product that usually gives some lift at the root. And then some type of mousse or whatever. Anything that adds body and that's, you know, best suits their hair type. So if their hair is frizzy, to use something to control the frizz on it. But usually the blown out hair will just, you know, enhance the style.
And by the way, I'm selfishly asking for the next place that I have to go. That way I know what to do. So.
Yeah, definitely. That makes a huge difference. Like using a root lifter or some type of product in a hair, a little bit of hair that's dirt on the hair works out well.
So you can work with it. Sure.
Yeah.
That makes sense. Now let's talk makeup. Makeup, is there a look? Do they say I want to go? I feel like most brides want to be the blushing bride. Is that right?
Yes.
Or do you have, is there a look where you know, maybe it's definitely heavier on the hand for makeup?
You know, very rarely do I have a bride come in that's going to come out with some full blown out like 40s glam look that she wants to have done because it just is not realistic for her, their wedding day. So most of the brides are natural bride look. You know, they just want their eyes to pop. They want their skin to be glowy. They don't want anything too heavy. But yet they do want to enhance everything. And they want to stand out in pictures, but yet they don't want to look like they have a lot of makeup on, which is one of my favorite looks too. So
have you ever had that bride that was, you know, really unique of what you just described?
Yes, I have. And it works well for somebody who does that, like who wears that look constantly. But if it's not you,
right,
don't try to recreate that look on your wedding day. It just won't work.
I remember I was struggling with red lips because I think they're so gorgeous. Yeah. But I was like, I don't know. I just don't know. They bleed. How's it going to look with the time of the year? You know, I don't know. I didn't do it. I wasn't that bold or brave.
Yeah. And red lips, transfers very easy onto somebody else. Like if you're kissing your groom or anybody else, like you can get it on your dress very easily.
That was the one comment my husband had. He had zero to say about any of this, except he's like, is it going to get on me? He said, I was like, I don't, you're right. Probably
for life.
Let's not do this. Yeah. So how many weddings, how many brides, makeup and hair are you doing in a year? Would you say at this point?
Oh, this year?
Well, I guess.
So, yeah. No, yeah. Last year we did about 123 weddings.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. So I have a team of artists.
I was going to say we. Okay, so you have a team. Okay.
Yes, I have a team. Yeah, there's probably about 15 of us that work together. I organize it pretty much. I'm always here for the trials, but yet I'm not on every single wedding that I go on to. I have some senior artists that work for me that I can just trust implicitly to go out on the job and just get the job done. So, but they all meet with the artist, whoever's doing their hair and makeup on the day of the trial. And if they have any questions about anything, they know to contact me.
How do you establish who gets which artist?
You know, I would say 90% of the brides that I do are all like natural brides. They're not too like over the top. So, and I just train my artists, like, you know, these are the products that we use. This is what we like to have done. This is what we have found that works best with everybody, you know, and there are the exceptions, but we can make those adjustments if needed. But for the most part, it's pretty standard.
Okay. Do you travel for weddings?
You know, yes, but only within the day I travel. I don't travel to like different countries.
Okay. I see. Yeah. And how far will you travel? Like, will you go out of the state?
Yeah, I will. And it's just that, you know, most people don't want to spend the money that's involved with doing that, you know? So it's pretty local, like within 2 hours, usually travel. So
sure.
Yeah.
And then because you have such a large team, I'm assuming you can accommodate multiple weddings in a day.
I do. Yeah, actually I do.
That's really cool. Yeah. I'm curious too, because I know I had a friend that did this. Do you have any brides that actually bring the stylist with them the day of, just touch them up to fix their hair in between, you know, the segments of the day, like photo session, before cocktail hour, things like that?
Yes. That's a good question. You know, I get asked that question all the time, and so many times they'll book an additional artist to stay to do the touch-ups.
Well, we get nervous.
Yeah, we do. But you know, the only time that you really need that is if the weather's going to be predicted to be bad that day. And if it's going to be windy, and if it's going to be extremely hot and you're going to be outside having photos, or if you're in the city and it's quite windy there, then you're going to need an artist to do your touch-ups after your photos, because most of the photos are done before the ceremony. But other than that, like, we use, you know, airbrush makeup, we use long wearing makeup and setting sprays and primer. So that makeup stays.
Yeah.
You know, the only thing that doesn't stay would be your lips, you know, so you have to bring something to touch up your lips with. But everything else pretty much stays through the entire day.
Now, so, do they actually, do they buy products from you when they're with you? Like, I would imagine if you had suggested a certain gloss or a certain, you know, liner, would they take that with you, with them?
Yeah, they're constantly taking pictures of whatever we use so that they have that for touching up throughout the day. Because that's, you know, and with eating and drinking, the lips go like right away.
Yeah.
So,
Now, do you ever have, because culturally we work with so many different brides who will have two and three complete attire changes throughout their wedding. And, you know, the attire gets changed, the hair is different for their big entrance into the reception. So in that case, you have to do multiple trials, right? Here's your look A, look B.
Yeah, no, you're right. They come in and usually we'll spend the whole day here doing that. You know, we'll try the first look, the second look, and the third look, which typically is very common in Hindu weddings, where they have, like, you know, the ceremony, and then they have the reception, and then they have the mendi, that all those, it's all photographs. So they want to look great in all those photos. So yeah. But you know, I've been doing this so long that I can, you know where to start, so that we're not like like completely exhausted by the end of the day. So we start with the updo first. We can take it down and do the down with curls or whatever it may be, rather than, you know, going back and forth and, you know, not trying to figure out where to start and where to end for that point.
Is there advice that you would give to a bride to prepare their skin in those weeks leading up to the wedding so that they do look their best?
Yeah,
that is a
selfish question.
Because so many times they'll come in and they'll have issues with their skin. So yeah, so I always recommend them to start having facials like 6 months out, making sure they don't have any skin reactions to any of the products that will be used on them, and just to bump up their skincare routine. Start if you're not like doing a daily regimen, like now's a good time to start doing it.
Got it. We talked a second about makeup trials. Do you insist on a makeup trial?
I do. Yeah. I can't even imagine, like, unless they wear absolutely no makeup whatsoever, like you definitely need to have a trial. Like, God forbid you had a reaction, you know, to the products that were being used on you on your wedding day, then, you know, that would be horrible. So.
And the same is to be said for hair. Do you insist on a hair trial?
I do. Yeah. And I'll let them come back as many times as needed to make sure that they're happy with, you know, whatever's being done, so that there's no question in their mind that this is the look. They feel great. And, you know, they feel confident they're going to look good in all the pictures. Yeah.
Now, let me ask, pricing wise, right? I'm curious, when they do you have packages, how does this work for them? Because when you mentioned coming back as many times as needed, do they just pay as they come? Or is there a package deal that you offer them? You come this many times, you know, or X amount of times. How does that work?
Yeah. So, you know, especially with the bride, because so many times I get the question, why is the bride so much more money than everybody else in the bridal party? And it's just that they're spending so much more. I'm spending usually a lot more time with them by answering emails and trying to get all to all their questions that they have, so that on wedding day, everything goes pretty smoothly. Mm-hmm. So, but what I do is I do offer them, a percentage off for their trials. And then if you make sure that they're completely happy with what we're doing. And then after that, if they have a certain amount of services that are being done with hair and makeup in the wedding, then I'll offer another percentage off. So it varies with each different wedding. I don't have like one set package for each particular wedding.
Right. And there's, you know, more or less people in a bridal party as well too. So I'm sure that factors into things as well, right?
Yeah. So the more people, obviously, the more I can, you know, be generous with them. So yeah. Right. Yeah.
Makes sense.
How much time do you need with the bride? Do you start the bride first and then the wedding party? What's a schedule like on a typical wedding day?
So typically, well, we count backwards from the time that they need to be finished, you know, with whatever the photographer is getting there, we count backwards from there. I allot for 45 minutes per person per service, and then I bring as many team members as needed to get the job done. So I don't want to be there 12 hours, and nobody wants us coming in at 3 a.m. So if I have a wedding party of 10 people that need both hair and makeup, then we're going to need at least 2 hair people and 2 makeup people. And we're going to have to start at like, we're going to need a full 5 hours to get that job done. So basically 45 minutes per person, per service. I start with the bride first thing in the morning, and I set her hair first. And I let that set stay in through the duration of the morning, so that an hour or two before the photographer comes, I can take her hair down and do the finish work on her. But yet that set in her hair is giving her hair a really good foundation, and she won't have to worry about it falling out throughout the day.
And do you do her makeup while it's setting or after you've styled it?
So I do the makeup, and then I take the hair down and do the finish work on the hair.
Yeah. Okay, great. And do you find, what factors would you recommend to brides to stay on schedule, to be prepared? Because being that we're in photography and videography business, a lot of times our crew will show up and hair and makeup is notorious for being behind. And I'm not saying this is anything to do with your company, but out there for brides, what advice can you give them to stay on schedule so that the day goes smoothly?
Yeah, you know, and that's a real tough one, because nobody wants to be, you know, the bad guy on wedding day. But yet I'm usually pretty good about staying on track and being on time and, you know, having as many people, as many artists there as needed to get the job done. So we're not running behind. Tell her to definitely go over the timeline with the artist who's doing her hair and makeup, and make sure that, you know, that you stay on track with that. Because a lot of times hair and makeup will get blamed for it. For running behind. And yet the, you know, the bridesmaids didn't want to get up. They were out late the night before and they would not come to the room to get the hair done. And then everybody wants to come at once to get it done. So, you know, you really have to have a conversation, you know, between the artist and the bride way before that day to make sure they're both on the same page about that, because you can run into problems with.
So it would almost be beneficial for there to be slots. If you have six girls that need hair and makeup done, each has a slot. You're getting your hair done at 12, your makeup done at 12:45, and then you're in the chair, and then next, that sort of thing.
You know what? In reality, that totally makes sense, but nobody ever sticks to that schedule on that morning. Because somebody might take a half hour to get done, another person may take an hour to get done, and you know, you have to take all those things into consideration when you're booking out that schedule. Okay. So if I told somebody to be there at 10 o'clock, and at 10 o'clock, I was still doing the 9:30, then the 10 o'clock is going to be mad. So I just give them to work within a time frame. So if there's, say there's five services and they both needed hair and makeup, you're going to need 5 hours, right? With two people. So just use that as a lot of time. So if somebody takes a half hour, you can only, you know, you're going to be running ahead for the next person, but not to have them all come at different times. It's just way too confusing and it never, ever pans out that way.
Okay. So just be around, be able to be accessed.
Yes, at a moment's notice, so that you can just hop in the chair. And you don't want us standing around. You want to keep us busy working the whole time. Mm-hmm. You don't want to stand in there, you know, like drinking coffee or whatever, waiting for somebody to show up. You just want us to constantly be going. And what we do is we just kind of tag team off of each other, because I'll go in and I'll evaluate the situation. If somebody's got a lot of hair and it's long and they're going to be wearing it down that day, then their hair is going to need to be set and it's going to need to stay up. Whereas somebody else whose hair is shorter, we can do them in the beginning and then wait to take that hair down later on. So it's a lot of it is just communication between you and the bride before, so that you know exactly what you're walking into that morning. So you're not surprised with, say, six bridesmaids with long, thick hair down to the middle of their back, and you know it's going to take a lot longer than 45 minutes to do. So
makes sense.
I try to get as much of that information from them beforehand.
That's great. I have two questions regarding wedding party. One is, what's the standard? Do the bridesmaids pay for their own hair, or is this paid? Is this gifted by the bride?
Various different things. I've heard brides who have gifted it to their bridesmaids, like maybe part of it, and then the bridesmaids will pay for their own makeup. So it's really whatever works. You know what I mean? There's no set rule for that. Mm-hmm. It depends on what they either had done at their wedding party, whatever they feel comfortable doing.
Okay. And then style-wise, do you find that what is more popular, where a bride will come up with a style that's consistent for the whole wedding party, like a very uniform look, or do brides generally leave this up to their bridesmaids? Maybe they all share an accessory.
Yes, definitely. I've seen anything where she allows them to do whatever they want with their hair. And then I've seen other brides where, like, you know, they definitely have to wear their hair up and she has the style picked out for them and that she wants them to wear.
And hopefully it's attractive.
Everyone. This is it. And that just is, you know, that's just how the bride, you know, that's how she rolls and that's how she likes things done. So.
Mm-hmm. Great.
Do you have a specialty when it comes to makeup, something that you're sort of known for?
The natural bride look. Yeah. Just because I do it so much, like I can do it. And we laugh about that all the time when we're here. Like we bring these huge kits with us, but we use the same, you know, 10 products maybe that we use all the time, you know.
Okay. Do you contour when you put on makeup?
Again, depends on the bride her skin tone. You know, if I tried doing a contour on somebody whose skin who was, you know, super fair, it would look horrible in pictures.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Oh, and for those listening, Kathleen, could you just really quickly explain what that is, contouring, just in case people don't know?
Sure. Contouring is when you go around the outer portions of your hairline and in your cheekbones to kind of highlight them with a darker color. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. And then you kind of blend it in. So it just really makes your eyes pop more, your cheekbones pop more, you know.
And it kind of is like, it's the whole part of like priming, if you will, right? It's sort of like that's what the beginning of it all before you even put on the foundation too.
Yeah, so you can do it that way. If, you know, again, it's like each different artist, you will may do a different technique with it. So it depends. Yeah.
Okay.
Product-wise, do you have a particular product that you recommend, that you swear by? Or I'm sure it's a variety of things, like your go-to for eyes, your go-to for lips and skin.
Yeah, you know, again, you're right. I have a variety of products, and it's usually like, you know, a key product in each line that I love. And I'm like, I can't live without this particular product. I'm a big fan of the Temptu airbrush foundation. Again, it's another tool that I personally like and I love. You know, it goes well. I've never had anybody have a complaint about it.
Now, is this,
but then I have, yeah.
Is that the apparatus that actually is an airbrush?
It's an airbrush gun, and it's a foundation that's sprayed onto the face, and it's very light,
flawless,
and it mimics. Yeah, it mimics the closest thing to skin, and it's not like a heavy application, which I love about it, and most of the brides love too. Yeah.
Do you wear that when you go out?
I don't. No, I don't. No. I don't.
Save it. Save it for brides.
I don't wear that much makeup. Yeah.
Okay. I'm just curious. Like, if it's such a perfect product, I would want to wear it. All the time.
All the time. Right,
I know.
Right.
I never did the airbrush. It makes you look like you have like literally no pores. It's the most beautiful look ever.
But you don't have pores anyway. Yeah. So
yeah. Oh, come on.
Yeah. It gives a very porcelain type look.
Yes.
To it. It doesn't look fake, you know.
No,
it looks very natural looking.
That's
and you
what's
can,
so nice.
You can blend it in. It's beautiful, I think. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Now, how do you feel that makeup and photography complement each other? Does it matter who they're working with photography-wise and how it's going to photograph? Do you need to know specific information before you do a bride's makeup?
Well, typically what I do is, and I hope I'm answering this correctly, is when the photographer's there, I'll have them take a few pictures to make sure everything looks okay in the photographs. And if we need to adjust anything, like if sometimes the bride will ask for like a lot of highlighter, and I notice sometimes in photographs that just kind of like looks very white looking. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we may have to change that. So is there a particular makeup that works well? I don't, you know what I mean? No, but you just want to make sure that, you know, that's why it's really important to have that trial done so that you know that the makeup is going to look good and they will take photographs with it with their phone or whatever else.
Okay.
Not that you can even compare that to a photographer, but at least they'll know that they're happy with the way it photographs.
Got it. Anything that you would recommend to brides who are just starting the search for the right makeup artist? What are the factors that they should look for, questions that they should ask? What's the criteria for finding the perfect team?
So, yes, and you know what? And start your search early and just, you know, make sure that you find a reputable company that has a strong online presence that mainly just does weddings and bridal makeup and hair, because it's really a specialty. You don't want to go to somebody who does it like just on the weekends or doesn't do just bridal work, because it's a whole set of different skills that you need to get that job done. Mm-hmm. And you know, you can do so much online now. That's how I find most of my brides, and they read the reviews and they know, and then they ask me what my booking policy is, you know, and they want to know how many artists I'll bring with me on that day. And, you know, I'm pretty straightforward with them with about everything that's going to be going on. And, you know, I don't really ever have a problem. You know, I hear different stories with people not having problems, but I think it's just because, you know, they didn't do enough research prior to that day.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And another thing is like, do it soon enough and just find out if they're available for your date and find out from them what the booking policy is.
Got
so
it.
That you can put a down payment down or whatever.
What is your booking policy? What percentage do you require to hold the date?
50% to hold the date.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And then the other half is paid the day of the wedding or prior to?
I like to be the week of the wedding. You know, but on special occasions, I'll do it on the day of if that's, you know, going to work out for them. But as long as that's taken care of, yeah. And it's all contracted, you know, so.
Sure. Okay.
Yeah.
So with the proper time planning, communication, it's a win-win. You feel that with the proper practice and trials, products, making sure that they're not bothering the skin, that you'll have a happy bride on the day of her wedding.
Absolutely. And, you know, just do your research early enough, book them early enough. A lot of times the biggest problem is that, you know, they'll call like 6 months out and they're like, oh, you're booked already. And they can't believe that you're booked already. Yeah. So especially if it's a popular date in like June or September and October. Yeah. To do it early enough.
Okay.
Yeah.
And your team does any day of the week. So Thursday weddings, Sunday weddings.
Yeah, we pretty much do anything. I think this year we even have one on a Monday.
Yep. Sometimes on like a like a Columbus Day weekend.
Yeah.
We're busy on those weekends too.
And do you ever have follow-up clients, clients that use you even after their wedding?
Yes, I do. For their baby showers and photos. All the time coming in.
I asked that question because I did the same thing. I loved my girl so much that I used her for my baby shower later on.
And then they recommend other brides to me all the time. Right. So I see them again, which is nice. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So
it's kind of cool because you become a life event.
Yeah.
You know, part of their lives, life events, you know? Gosh, Kathleen, thank you so very much for
it was such a pleasure.
Yeah, for your insight and clearly your expertise. And for everybody who's listening, please make sure to follow Kathleen on Facebook, Pinterest, YouTube, right? You have some videos on YouTube?
Yes.
Awesome. Yeah. You can also visit her website at KathleenBenjamin.com. And I will spell that for you, K-A-T-H-L-E-E-N. BenJamin.com.
Thank you, Kathleen.
Thank you very much.
And for all the other listeners, please make sure to visit our website as well, podcast.livepicturestudios.com. And please make sure to follow us on Facebook and Instagram at livepicturestudios.com.
Just again, if you haven't already subscribed, please subscribe and rate us, especially on Apple Podcast. It really does help us. And email us at podcast@livepicturestudios.com or #LPSpodcast with questions or anything that you guys would like to share.
This podcast has been produced by Kwa Lee, Natalia Delgado, and Mark Falcon, and our lovely editor, Nicole Palmetti. And music has been provided by Ian Post and Artlist. This podcast has been powered by Kvibe Go Live.
Until next time, thank you. Bye-bye. And... Happy planning.